Welcome to Work With Me, the show that focuses on untapped talent, unsung heroes, and getting people back to work. I'm your host, Erica Collins, and I'm here with a wonderful opera singer, Marcella Adame. Marcella, how are you?
I am great, thank you.
And where are you from, Marcella?
I'm originally from California. I grew up in a small town called San Bernardino.
And how did you make it to New York City?
I actually came here, I did a performance with a group, and when I saw New York, I just fell in love with New York, and I decided I wanted to come back and stay here.
Okay, and has the transition been easy for you?
Not in the beginning, no. It was a struggle getting settled here because I had to figure out where I was going to live and what kind of work I could do in order to remain in New York.
How did you come about singing opera?
I was introduced into opera as a child. My grandmother, she used to listen to classical music. She used to play the records of all the great sopranos. And I just fell in love with the music. And I always had it in my mind I wanted to be a musician when I grew up because of that.
What kind of training did you receive for opera?
I decided when I was in college to audition for a group, and I got in. And from there, I studied classical music, and then I transferred to a University of Texas, and I entered into the music program there.
And how different would you say the training is for opera versus other types of music?
Singing opera is a lot of training. It's a discipline. You have to know how to breathe, your posture. You have to know the different languages. You have to know the rhythms, the articulation of the words. You have to know the story behind the songs within the opera.
What is your favorite opera story?
Gosh, I have many, but actually I would have to say Madame Butterfly by Puccini.
Mm.
Yes.
And why do you like that one specifically?
I love the story of it. It's a very dramatic role. She is a young geisha girl, and she falls in love with an American sailor. And even though, you know, she's knowing that he may not come back for her, you know, it's a tragic love story. She has faith that he will, and the music is gorgeous in that opera. Yes.
What notable shows have you been in?
I've been in a couple of operas this past year. I was in Viva Chiure, Wagner Opera. I was in Norma, and I was in La Traviata this year with a New York Opera Forum.
Okay, and do you have anything coming up now?
I haven't worked on anything yet for this year. I am working on a CD, though, which will be out hopefully next month.
Okay, and what is the name of the CD? Do we know yet?
I haven't decided, but I'm sort of thinking like Marcella's favorite arias to sing.
Oh, very nice. And what's the focus going to be?
Mainly the focus is going to be the songs that the people love from New York, because I am busking now in New York subways. And when I sing, I want to sing for the people, and I know what they like now, so I want to sing all the songs that they love to hear. Yes.
Speaking of the subways, you're part of the Subway Diaries?
Yes.
Okay, what exactly is that?
I'm not too familiar with it, but I know the girl that wrote it. She's a close friend of mine. Basically, she goes and she does like a introduction of the different people that perform in the subway. And she tells short stories about them, and she also tells stories about her experience in the subway as an artist as well.
Okay, and your placement in the stories are specific too?
Mainly the stories that she puts about me, I would imagine, would be like my experience as how I progressed as a musician in the subways performing there, because it's a whole totally different experience than singing, you know, in a studio or on a stage.
Do you prefer singing on stage or a live crowd or in studio?
Oh, I love the live crowd because it's sort of like it kind of makes me give me the momentum that I'm actually entertaining the people and they enjoy it, and it makes me really happy to know that they love to hear me sing.
Okay, yeah. And what inspiration or pieces of encouragement could you give young opera singers or singers who want to come to New York City?
In the beginning, it's not going to be easy, but if you pursue it and your perseverance within it, you have the strength to do it, because it's an experience to have, it's a journey to go through. I would recommend that any artist, they should do it, because in the end, you never know what the outcome is going to be.
So. And where can we find your work online?
I'm hoping to do a website soon. I know I haven't done it. I need to do it. But I am on YouTube.
Okay.
So there's some people that recorded me performing in the subway that have posted it on YouTube.
Ah, beautiful. Thank you so much for singing for us today. And we really appreciated you coming. Thank you.
Thank you.
Welcome to Work With Me. I'm your host, Amanda Lundy, and today I have two amazing guests, Ina and Valerie from Crop Hunger Walk. Ina is the coordinator.
New York City Crop Walk coordinator.
And Valerie is a committee member. So today we're going to be talking about Crop Hunger Walk here in New York City and across the country. Ladies, would you, Eden, can you tell us a little bit about your roles at Crop Hunger Walk?
Well, as the coordinator of the walk, I'm responsible for a variety of things. The biggest thing is pulling together the committee, which is responsible for planning the walk, for logistics, for going out and seeking corporate sponsorship, for recruitment, for talking to neighborhood and community groups and getting them involved in the walk. And then all of the nuts and bolts things like processing money and processing walker envelopes and that sort of stuff.
So sounds like you got your hands full.
Yes.
Definitely. And Valerie, as a committee member?
As a committee member, most of the committee members have specific tasks to accomplish. I, on the other hand, pick up the slack. Wherever it's missing, wherever it's lacking, I come along and I boost them up.
Cool. So kind of like the task safety net?
Yeah.
All right, well, excellent. Well, I guess we'll start talking a little bit about what CROP is. Ina, if you could tell us a little bit about where CROP started, what the acronym CROP stands for.
Well, originally the acronym CROP stood for Christian Rural Overseas Program. And it started in the Midwest. It was a program to help Midwest farmers find ways to be able to gather together their excess produce and grain and to then be able to ship that to war-torn Europe and Asia. Today, CROP stands for Communities Responding to Overcome Poverty. The original CropWalk did not start until 1969. And that is when a group of about 1,000 people in Bismarck, North Dakota, got together. They walked, they raised money, and they raised about $25,000. The following year in York County, Pennsylvania, that walk was officially the very first walk that was referred to as a CROP walk. And it's grown to the point where there are CROP walks all over the country, and there are over 1,100 CROP walks all around the United States today.
Right, and about 2,000 communities walk annually, right?
Yes.
So hopefully they're raising a decent amount of money when...
It is the major fundraising activity of Church World Service, which is the parent organization of CROP Walk, and they work with partners around the world to address issues of poverty, hunger, and disaster relief. And they work with people who are on the ground there who know the communities that they're in and what kinds of things will help to raise the communities out of the situations that they might find themselves in.
Right, which is far better than, if I may get a little political, better than, you know, having a politician speculate that things are fine. It's fine. As we often get, we're like, oh, not fine at all. But yeah. But it's good to hear that you're, helping get this CROP walk off the ground and kind of hitting the ground walking, running, if you will. But it began in the 1970, and you've been working with it for how long?
16 years in New York City. One of the associate pastors at our church became the chair for the New York City CROP Walk Committee, and he mentioned to a couple of us one Sunday at coffee hour that he was doing this, and he invited us to walk. And 15 years later, here we are, deeply involved in participating in CROP Walk and in using it as a tool to raise awareness about hunger issues here in New York City, the state, around the country, and around the world.
And we were just talking about fighting hunger here in New York City. And we were talking about rooftop gardens, which, you know, in our minds would be an amazing thing to have all over the city. But there are certain places around the country that those are set up, correct?
There are still places in the country which are rural, say particularly in Appalachia, where funds from CROP Walk will go to actually help sustain a garden or a family farming plot.
Right.
I think they used to call them kitchen gardens, where you'd grow like a small amount of food that was particularly meant for the family.
Right.
But also it goes toward things such as providing maybe a couple of chickens or a couple of rabbits so that a family can raise animals that can then be sold, which brings money into the family and that can be used to buy additional food.
My next question is for Valerie. Why do you walk?
In developing nations, people walk as much as 6 miles a day for clean water and food. 1 in 9 people worldwide is hungry. and has to walk large distances to get their food. So we walk in solidarity with them. By our walking, we feel what they feel.
So, CropWalks
are interfaith events that build community while also making a difference locally and globally. Crop Hunger Walks help support grassroots hunger fighting development efforts around the world. Additionally, we not only look out to the world beyond ourselves, but we also look within. 25% of the dollars collected from our sponsors is kept within the community where the walk takes place.
Awesome. So definitely focusing on here at home as well as globally.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of like when you're on an airplane and you put your mask on before assisting anybody else.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. That's a very good analogy. I like
Is
that
it?
One.
Thank you.
I have to remember that.
All right. Well, back to Ina. I guess, what are the current goals of Crop Hunger Walk? Do you have, kind of some bullet points on, or is it just a general?
Do you mean locally or nationwide?
I guess more locally, if we're talking about putting the mask on.
One of the things that we're very concerned with locally is childhood hunger. 22% of children in New York City are food insecure, which means they don't necessarily know where their next meal is coming from. And we like to work with local food pantries and soup kitchens to be sure that they have what they need so that families who are coming in, particularly in the kind of situation where you're trying to make it to the end of the month, whether your dollars that you earn just don't make it to the end of the month, or your food stamps just aren't covering as much as they used to. So a number of the soup kitchens and food pantries that we work with, not only do they supply food to fill in the gap, but some of them have training programs. They train people to work in the food industry, whether it's doing some culinary sorts of things. They train people in other jobs that might be available that will provide them with additional income. So there are quite a few things that are going on. And the goal is to try to overcome poverty in New York in various ways.
Right. Well, and that's amazing that they aid in that way as well. It's not just feeding, but it's also to help, like, teach Amanda fish kind of thing.
That's exactly right.
Which is awesome. And as I've had a lot of experience in the restaurant industry, there's usually some food in there too. Like this. There's usually some food about that you could get your hands on too. Well, that's so awesome. And how much money would you say is the annual that Crop Walk brings in?
Our local walks have ranged from, I think, a low of about 8,000 to a high at one point where we actually got a matching grant of approximately $50,000. So our actual top is probably about $25,000 that we've raised in any given year. But we had 2 years where there was a foundation that was trying to increase the profile and get people to notice Crop Walk, and they matched what we raised. Because that's one of the really important goals, is to let people know that there is hunger locally. Everyone sort of assumes that there's hunger globally, but as I said earlier, there are many children going hungry in New York, and a large percentage of the American population is going hungry on any given day. So this is something that we need to be aware of, and as individuals, in any way that we can, work to help to overcome that.
Right, and I think that also stems from some media use. Like, we're portrayed as this, like, over-consuming, obese country. But when you have these kids that don't know where their next meal is coming from, it's kind of hard to balance those. They're like, oh, we overconsume, we're doing all of this terrible stuff, but then we also can't feed our children.
A lot of people in this country are obese, not because they eat too much, it's because they eat the wrong things. And when you're very poor, you eat what's affordable and what's going to fill you up. And if that's a lot of potatoes or a lot of white rice or a lot of bread, then that's what you eat, so that rather than feeling hungry, you and your children can feel as though you have something in your bellies. And it's important to understand that in order for people to be able to eat properly, eat nutritiously, that takes money.
Absolutely. And I couldn't agree with you more. There have been times where, like, I've been pretty poor, and I go into the grocery store and I'm like, oh, Little Debbie's. Like, I could get a whole box of Little Debbie for like a dollar. And I'm like, well, yeah, we'll do that. And
or the flavored noodles.
Got me through college. Totally got me through college, flavored noodles. But yeah, you're absolutely right. And I think we were actually discussing this a little bit before about, as you know, when you start educating children about nutrition, that's when we start to kind of change the game a little bit, where we can. I have a friend that did a project on eating on $4 a day. So a food desert, you probably know what a food desert is, but for those who don't know, a food desert is somewhere it's very difficult to find and buy nutritious food. I've never personally lived in one of those places, but I hear there's like several of them down south.
You know, actually, you may live in a food desert.
Oh, do I?
There are places in New York City that are essentially food deserts, where a lot of the chain supermarkets have closed up, and you don't necessarily have a local bodega that sells fruit and vegetables and various whole grains and milk and juice and a variety of things. You know, they tend to carry just some of those quick things that you run in for that you forgot. So that if you don't have a place such as a good supermarket or a green market where you can go and get fresh fruit, fresh vegetables, or a good supermarket or a fish store where you can go and get some fish or chicken or what have you, you are living in a food desert. It doesn't have to be someplace far away and rural. We have food deserts in New York. There are communities that are complaining, and one of them is a community in East Harlem, which had access previously to a very large supermarket on 125th Street near Lexington Avenue, and now that's closed.
Yeah.
So their next nearest big supermarket is a ways away.
Right.
So this becomes an issue, not just far away, but also right here in New York.
And you know what? Just hearing you talk about it, I was like, oh my gosh, you're right. I lived up on in Harlem, West Harlem. But the closest thing to me was a bodega, and I was like, all right, well, I can have some Oreos or some Pop-Tarts or some...
All of that is true.
Yeah.
However, you also have to consider the media. We have Pop-Tarts, we have Cocoa Puffs, we have a wide range of oversweetened cereals that are being advertised on children's shows. And children are impressionable. They want Captain Kangaroo. They want sugar puffs. They don't want a healthy meal. They don't want granola.
Right.
Okay, because it hasn't been fed, brainwashed into them.
Right, well, and I guess I have heard that now they're starting nutrition classes very young, so I'm hoping that in the next, you know, 20 years, we'll see a little bit of change there when it comes to like nutrition and being able to feed yourself, especially on like a lower income.
Because I happen to remember being in elementary school, and school still had kitchens where you went to learn to, if you were in kindergarten, you would learn to make some chocolate chip cookies. But it was also an opportunity for the teacher, the home economics teacher, to give you information about proper eating and the kinds of things that you should eat. And I remember taking various kinds of cooking classes through sixth grade. We used to have home economics, and that was a big push to what home economics was. Mm-hmm. But that's something that, you know, with changing times, the demands of adding different kinds of subjects to school schedules and what have you, we've lost that. And I think that has created some problems for us as a country in young people growing up without the idea of what might constitute a nutritious meal.
So these are, again, my two guests from the New York City Crop Hunger Walk. Thank you so much for tuning in. Again, I'm Amanda Lundy, and this is Work With Me.